And it's one part carbon to three parts iron, four parts in total. And that's how you can look that up. The e-reader actually will tell you anything that you want to know for as far as how to craft it. Hello everyone, Thranxes is here and welcome back to Stationeers episode 5, where we're starting to get things underway. So we have our automatically adjusting for the sun solar panels up here. They're doing really good, right? They're doing as advertised. They're doing great. They're going to track all at once together now. Boom. Look at that. And as we add more, we'll just be able to program them in. One of the main things that I'm starting to run into, though, is that there just isn't enough power stored. In fact, we're generating a ton of power with three solar panels, but we're really not utilizing that much of it. This green light means the APC is fully charged. It's really just one large cell, and that is not enough to power the computer and other minor manufacturing through the night with the light on. It's just not enough. So what we need is a solid battery. Now over here, let's turn this light on. At the electronics printer, we can make not a large cell. That's one of the ones we keep in our suit. But there it is, the battery kit requires steel. So we're not able to do that yet. Now what I did is I went out and I gathered a lot of materials for smelting, but we already have the furnace, right? The furnace. So we're going to set that up so that we can make some steel. And then the next thing we're going to need actually is one of the hydraulic pipe bender, right? We're going to need one of those. So we're going to queue that up to start being made here, which we already have one, right? Okay, so we manufactured one of those as well. This is actually, I'm thinking, going to go over here. I expanded the roof this way because we're going to add lights over this way as well. Make sure we have plenty of space to do what we want to do and walk through here without any issues, hopefully. Now, it was mentioned in the comments about running wires and everything under the frames, which we will do. This really was just something we were doing to get started. Eventually, they will all be wired in through the frames like this one. It's easy enough to do. You just kind of have to set the time aside to do it, and we're going to once we get ourselves situated. But we're kind of under the gun. We're going to need oxygen at some point for our suit, but we have quite a bit of oxygen, and even when our propellant runs out, we'll be able to use our waste tank for propellant to some degree. So that's not necessarily a huge thing. Let's see. So what I need is the tool belt. We'll put the mining belt back, right? So we have five wires. We're going to need more wires. So I think we'll go ahead and kick out the gold or the copper from here. And we'll just put everything in here for now because it's not going to matter. It's going to be going into the hydraulic pipe bender before too long. Which, you know what else we can do since we're not charging batteries? We can turn that off. We can try to conserve power as much as possible. Would be nice if we had like motion sensing lights. Oh, see, that'll be cool. We'll have to do that at some point. That'll be pretty neat. The furnace, I'm thinking, we're going to put over here. So we're going to build this frame way out this way a little bit. But then, no. It should be here, right? This should be the edge of the manufacturing area, and it should start going this way. So these frames will go up, and that's where we'll start to box in this room. Right, I like that. Okay, well, that's going to be my plan. Let's take all the copper that we have. We're going to need it for wires. And then over here, we're going to go ahead and get our cables going. And then what I'm going to do is I'm going to go ahead and let the cables come out while I work on extending our frames and getting our grid system over here that we can snap stuff to. And I will bring you back after I have made some progress. Okay, and so I just kind of spent the night gathering resources. We're starting to need a lot of iron. We're good on gold. We're a little low on copper, but mostly what we need is iron. Now, I'd like to think when we start digging into the surface here, because we're going to start building our base into the moon, that we'd be able to get resources nearby. That would be ideal. Oh, I left something on pulling power. That's not good, but looks like the solar panels are doing just fine. Let's go ahead and kick our battery charger on. And in fact, what we're going to do, well, it should charge pretty quickly. Let's go ahead and let it charge. We've got a small battery in, so I had to replace the battery here just to let our power go through the night. I tried to turn everything off to conserve as much power as possible. The furnace. So the furnace is going to go over here. I started laying down a bunch of frames. I went and made more frames. And, of course, let's get our iron going. Power critical. That's our cue to just accept the battery as it is. So we'll do that real quick. Oops, wrong slot. There we go. Power simply back to low. There we go. All right, and we're going to build these frames here. There we are. And I went ahead and installed a light, even though I haven't wired it yet. We are just going to run the wires on the edge of the frame for now for a lot of this stuff. We don't need our light on, but we'll light up this area so we can see the pipe bender. This is not a final setup, so to speak. Why are you not charging? Is there that much power being pulled through here? Are they not tracking properly? Hold on. Let's take a look. Which cycle are they even on? You know what we need? We need a manual. We need a manual control or a manual override. Waiting for charge to be greater than 400, then point to zero? No, 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 no. Try this one. They somehow got messed up. See, this is exactly why, and this is what we're going to focus on in this episode. As you can see, they're going haywire. Because, and this is the problem, is the logic command is telling them to go to a setting and then checking to see if it's under a certain amount of wattage. And yeah, exactly. If it's not under that wattage, then it just rushes. Oh, it may have found the proper cycle. Hold on. Cycling it through states, we might have got lucky. Condition. It's waiting for afternoon to send a 60 command because power's not. Okay, that's pretty good. That's pretty good. But it's for that reason that we need to address that and we need to get a manual override. But on top of a manual override, we need more battery to make it through the night. Okay, so for the furnace, what we're going to do is the furnace is actually a pretty interesting machine. So it turns out it really doesn't need anything at all. And it has a lot of inputs and outputs. So depending on how you want it to look and face, this is how I want it to look. I want it to face that direction. And I want it to be about like that. So we're going to do it here. Let's see how that looks. So I'll have my input on this side. My output on that side, this will release the material. That's my pressure gauge. Starting, we have power and data over here, which we actually don't need unless we're going to automate it, and we're not going to be automating the furnace anytime soon. I guess I shouldn't say anytime soon. I don't know. We'll have to wait and see, but I don't have any plans to do it right this second. All right, so let's get, you know what? I'm going to wire up this light. Well, I'll wait and do that at night when it's darker. But what we need here, what we're going to make is a... Let's go with gas tank storage for starters. We'll make one of those. This makes a lot of your tubing and atmospheric stuff. Well, that was interesting. Just kind of threw it into my hand there. Okay. We're also going to make... Let's see. We have pressure regulator. Ooh. Well, then we're talking about hooking up stuff to it. Yeah, I don't know if I want to go that road. We're probably going to go low tech to start. We just don't want to waste anything. But we get, look, we get some pieces over here. Some valves. Yeah, 20 pipes. Right, for the airlock. A console. That's right, we get a console to start. Active vent and some sensors and two airlocks. Yeah, I don't think we'll need those just yet, but I will take the pipes and the two valves. That's pretty neat. Or the 20 pipes and the two valves. So what we're going to do is we're actually going to, let's get this to be a corner piece. We're going to find that this is the output. So let's go ahead and I kind of want to weld those frames over there. Let me, here, let's stow our ore real fast. No, not the pipes, though. We'll take those back. All right, good. And then we'll take the tool belt, put the mining belt back. Wonderful. Okay. Then we'll put these pipes and valves in our backpack. Excellent. So what are we looking for here? Oh, look, our batteries. Oh, it's not full yet. It's almost full. Iron walls, iron sheets, because I want to weld some of these frames, just not all of them. So what we're going to do is we're actually going to weld the bottom frames here. So we have something to walk on inside of the wall because we don't really need to get down here. Now you can, with a pry bar, you can actually pull these back up if you need to get down here, or I think it might be with the wrench for these. You'll have to see. Let's see. Wrench. Yeah, it is the wrench. The wrench will pull up the iron panel, and you'll get your, you'll just have your bare frame. No problem. Okay, but this way we can at least walk back here, and we can see what's back here. So you have an exhaust output for your furnace, and an input for gases. So the furnace actually runs off of pressure. I guess it just brute force crushes things inside of it. It can handle immense pressures and temperatures. You might not be able to handle the light that it creates if you get the gauge up too high, but from what I've seen, this thing is almost indestructible. It's pretty darn tough. Now, so what happens is you put in some oxides and volatiles in here, which are different combinations of hydrogen and oxygen and other gases, and then you put in your ore, and through brute force it pressurizes everything together, and you can read how much pressure and how hot it is here. You can use different ratios of oxide to volatiles to control just what kind of mixture that you get. And that is how it works. So you can automate it, like I talked about with the power and data port, even though you don't really need to. And you can sort of let the pressure stay in there. So to use this thing, you don't even need to wire up the pipes like I'm doing. You don't even have to do that. You can use this thing without anything, but you're going to have lingering pressure, and over time you might, it might cause a problem just because of pollutants and impurities and stuff in your fuel. So what I want to do here is what I'm trying to do is to conserve energy and gases. What I'm trying to do is to create a place to refill our propulsion tank, because our propulsion tank can really be anything, right? So we're going to put a valve because we want the exhaust of our reactions at any given pressure to come down here. And what we don't want, though, is for that pressure to be too much. All right, so let's see if we pick up the gas tank storage, because we're also going to need a canister. I believe that's what this is here. I never installed that light. I should have wired up that light. There we go. Yes, that's what we need, an air canister. Good. Then, actually, you know what? I'm going to wire up that light now that it's nighttime, and I'll bring you back when I'm done with that. Much better. Now we're all lit up. Okay, and there's our canister, and we can turn off our headlight. Let's go ahead and actually turn this off and grab our battery and put the little one in there so we can get our life support back on track. All right, so as we were over here with our gas tank storage, we're going to see just how exactly, let's see, this thing is set up, because I think, yes, we can have it facing up, which is what I want. Now, what I was saying just a second ago was about how we're not going to have anything to regulate the pressure. So what that means is we're going to have to manually pay attention and actually ensure that we don't open the valve onto the air tank before it's actually at a pressure that the air canister can handle. Now, I'm not exactly sure what it's rated at, and I'm pretty sure that this thing is considered airtight. It doesn't leak. Let's go ahead and we'll put a canister in there. Now, what the color of the canister is and what its label is, you can set with the spray paint and the labeler and all of that. But really, all I want to do, because your propellant can be anything, it starts as nitrogen. You can see here, if I pull it out, it says canister, nitrogen. It's labeled and painted. It's pretty nice. But it can be anything. As long as you don't leave your welder on, it shouldn't be a problem venting a bunch of potentially toxic and or flammable gases behind you. You just got to be careful near heat sources. But it's good in the beginning. At the very least, it gives us an option for if we want to save our nitrogen tank, possibly, and use other gases, which we likely will. Now, most of them can hold about 5,000 kilopascals. So what I do is you just wait until that's the pressure here, and then you'll flip the valve, and this will turn on. So let's demonstrate this, because what we need to make, in order to get the things we want, is we need to make some steel. And I think what we're going to end up doing to keep the lights on is, again, we're going to have to do a battery swap.
Power critical.
Power there we low. Go. And then again, we're going to swap batteries just like that. I should just move that battery from there to there. It's going to be fine. Once we get steel, a lot of our problems for energy are going to go away. It's just that that one little battery can't sustain everything throughout the night that we're doing. Now, to find out how to make steel in-game, I wanted to show this. It's going to pull a little bit here from what I'm doing, but let's see. There's no battery and no cartridge. Right, I would have... Well, we have the battery here, which is fine. We'll go ahead and put that battery in there for now. And the cartridge should be over here. Oh, sorry about the darkness, everyone. I've been trying to keep us in light. The e-reader. Go ahead and take this cartridge so we can talk a little bit about how you're supposed to figure this stuff out in the game, because I've done a lot of research. I've looked at some videos, some entries online. Some people, you know, the game's still pretty new, so there is some guesswork, some different answers and stuff, but the game usually will have what you need. Let's go ahead and turn it on, right? And if we go to what we're trying to make, which is steel, you can see that it says, well, you make this in the furnace. The pressure has got to be in between 100.0 kilopascals to 100 million. Oh wow, is that 100,000 million? Oh wow. And temperature's got to be between 600 Kelvin and 100,000 Kelvin. So it's got to be hot, but it can't be too hot. And then it's one part carbon to three parts iron, four parts in total. And that's how you can look that up. The e-reader actually will tell you anything that you want to know for as far as how to craft it, and we're going to put our tablet back inside there. Now let's go ahead and grab what we want. So now what we want is iron, but we're going to separate it. Now the easiest way that I found to separate stuff is you press R to pull up your split menu and then switch hands, and then every time you press the F button to split, you stick it in the locker. So 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Okay, and in that way we have 40 iron, which is what we're going for, and 50 iron there. Okay, good. Because we're going to do 90 iron, and then we're going to do 30 coal. So let's see, 50, 50. That's just what it is. Okay, and we have 30 coal and 50 and 40 iron for 90 iron. So that's 1-to-3 ratio, 30 to 90. And the other aspect of doing this is you sort of have to, not sort of, but you do, you have to do this at night. So you can experiment, and then the reason is because we have to use volatiles and oxide as the fuel for our furnace. So here's what we're going to do is we're going to split these up. Now you can experiment. Let's say 2 volatiles, I think, is what we're going to work with here. But you can experiment how many of each combination of oxide and volatiles you need for a given pressure or temperature. And we'll just take 1 oxide. Oh no! Oh no, the sun came up! Oh, the sun came up. See, and that was the other half of what I was going to say, is the moment the sun comes up over the horizon, your stuff will sublimate. It will go from solid to gas immediately. Immediately. No ifs, ands, or buts about it. And unfortunately, I thought I could beat the clock, and I was not able to. So unfortunately, we'll have to do it at the start of next night. So in the meantime, I'm going to go ahead and grind. I think we're going to need more iron and copper. So that's what I'm going to do, and I'll bring you back in a few. All right, so we're back, and this is the second time that I've checked in and found that my solar panels were not aligned to the sun properly. I was trying to gather iron out to complete what we were working on and was not even able to do that before I looked up as I passed by and I saw the solar panels were not aligned. It was visible to me from while I was out grinding. And so we're going to solve this because we don't really have the time to set up the manual override yet. The manual override is for when it's a much bigger deal because there are so many of them. So if we have to manually align them, what is going on here? Why do you not, you don't look flat. Hold on. So you're at 100 degrees instead of 90 degrees. Oh my goodness. So slight calculations that are varied in the... Ah, that's so rough. Okay, let's see if we can get the director back on track here. So it's going to be 60. Nope, 70. There you go. There's your 70. Boom. Okay, good. And that should command everybody else to 70. All right, so what was happening was the slight dips in the wattage that the solar panel was expecting to receive, let's make sure we didn't rotate it 90 degrees, i.e. was expecting to be in the 400s, would be ever so slightly if the rotation caused it at certain extreme angles, which is why it happened during the morning and afternoon, to be just under 400 watts before its time. It would send the logic cycle into a loop, because what it depends on is that during the adjustment that's being made, it immediately goes up over 400 watts before the computer has a chance to recognize if it's past it. And that's sort of how it works. So whenever that solar panel dips below 400 watts arbitrarily, it's going to send it on a cycle that is not recoverable, because what happens is the solar panels spend so much time moving from point A to point B and scanning back and forth that in the process they lose, well, they lose what they're, they lose what they're trying to do, because they're in the process of moving every time it checks to see if it's under 400 watts, and it never gets to the spot that it needs to get. Now it might catch itself and fix itself at some point, but you don't want to depend on that. That's not what you're trying to do. All right, so we've got our iron and coal still ready to go. We're going to make quite a bit of steel, and we're going to toss it into the electronics printer. Let's see, we have a lot of gold. Let's get some more iron in there. I think we, yes. Let's see, we'll turn off the arc furnace. And then that's already off. The pipe bender is off. Good, good. This can be off here. We can turn this light off. Let's start trying to conserve our power now. As we've got one more night, we have to make it. Nothing in the auto lathe, really. I'm sure we have more iron that we can afford to. Yep, 50 right there. We're going to turn everything back on a little bit. Here, we'll leave you on and open so the iron just shoots out into the computer as soon as it's melted. This furnace is going to be pretty good to start with, but eventually we're going to want a different setup, one that uses chutes and all other kinds of stuff. But for now, really, we just need to get steel so that we can get some better batteries so that we can capture enough of this charge to make it through the night, because realistically, when the solar panels are functioning properly, they fill the battery up and then some. And then plus, we can always add more solar panels as we go. So I'm going to go ahead and let this iron get smelted and bring you back when the sun is set so that we can get to using the furnace. All right, let's get the lights back on. The sun is down. Now, one of the things we're going to make really quick is another canister because I want to actually capture 2 tanks worth of this toxic gas, because the stuff that comes off the furnace is going to be bad news. It's nothing you're going to want to breathe or use for fuel for your blowtorch or any of that noise. At least I don't think you can use it for fuel for your blowtorch. Maybe you can. You'd have to use an atmos scanner or an atmos reader cartridge in your handheld tablet and scan the canister to actually find out. But let's go ahead and get our stuff sorted. All right, so again, we're going to go 2 volatiles. Very good. And then we're going to take, after 2 volatiles, 1 oxide. Now that's just based on trial and error, things that I read online, what people talk about, and then also like I was saying, there's a lot of, in this game, you can assemble the stuff yourself in your own ratio and figure out exactly what you need to get the pressure and temperature range that you need. But the one for steel, it's a pretty big window. It really is. So let's go ahead. We're going to put in 2 volatiles. You can see that added to the pressure and 1 oxide. So now that is enough to activate this. It doesn't have a high pressure yet, but we haven't crunched everything. Now it causes some sort of reaction to happen. We'll put in our 90 iron. Some sort of reaction to happen between volatiles and oxide. Now you can see the contents. It's going to be smelting iron ore, 50. We want 40 more, and then 30. So we're trying to make 120 grams of steel using the 1:3 ratio of coal to iron. So now you can see we're starting to build up a little bit of pressure because remember, it's calculating the pressure based off of all of the ore and everything you put in it as well. Now, when we push this button, let's make sure our valve is off. We don't want this canister blowing up on us. That is a thing that can happen because it's going to get very high on pressure and very hot. So we're going to activate it. You can see it's going up in temperature. So it's about 2,000. That's actually not that much. It's probably because we put so much iron and coal into it, but you can see it gave us our 120 grams of steel, which is very good. Now, because we didn't get as much pressure as I hoped for, it's only 1,800. We're still going to go ahead and fill up this tank. And that should be enough. And look at that, 15, 87, 86. It's going down. I'm not sure why. Let's try it again. Let's see if we can get it to fill up a pressure into the tank, and we're going to try to cool it off. It's a little hot, which is probably why the pressure was changing as it cooled down. We're going to go ahead and just leave it there for now and let it cool down that way. All right, let's go ahead and take a look. 1464, so it is cooling off, but it's emergency air. Okay, so we didn't get that much pressure because we tried to do a bunch of ore at once. That's fine. It was really just to not waste it. We still have quite a bit of propellant in our pack, but now we have some extra propellant. We have 1400 extra propellant should we need it. And I'm not sure exactly why It's leaking. It's not open. It's got to just be that it's not necessarily leaking, but it's cooling off. It's probably really warm, actually. So if I pick it up, my temperature doesn't change. Yeah, probably leave it in there till the temperature comes down a good bit. And anyways, the important part is we got the steel. That's what matters. So the first thing we're going to do is print ourselves a battery. Heck, not just one, we're going to print two. Then we're going to turn around and let's go ahead and take both of these. We'll put these in storage for now. We're not going to install them just yet. The next thing we're going to need is a solar control circuit. No, we're not doing that yet. Oh no, what we need are some large cell batteries. Yep. That's going to help us sort of weather this storm, as we'll be able to charge multiple large cell batteries, and then we won't be beholden to juggling the only large cell battery we have out of the APC. Plus, the APC is really kind of an up system to keep your stuff on at night. It's not meant to power everything at night, it's just meant to power small stuff to keep you through interruptions. And so, what we're going to do, let's see, we'll make two to start. What we're going to do is we're going to have APCs utilized just like we need them to be. For example, the control panel that manually realigns the solar panels in the event that they're out of whack is going to be powered by its own personal ups, and in that way that it will, it'll always have power. It won't be a thing we'll have to worry about. So you can see everything is cooling off, the pressure is decreasing. Now I should have really put a place to vent the gases, but my thought was we would just keep filling up canisters with whatever was left and we just wouldn't vent any of it. Without a pressure regulator though, it's not going to force the air here. All it's going to do is match the pressure, but for now, that's good enough. We're not going to have to use this too much. That's why I made 120 steel at a pop. So let's talk about the plan moving forward. Oh, we're out to the land of no lights over here. We're going to have to change that. But we need to get our batteries wired up. So what I'm thinking is we're going to stare down into this direction, right? And we're going to do sort of a mini power monitoring solar panel station right down here. So that if you're running up to the top and you need to mess with the solar panels, you can do it from down here because a lot of our work is going to start moving underground. And there go our lights. That is indeed our power not making it through the night, which hopefully we will be changing that soon. So I'm going to start wiring things up. And I think that's where we're going to wrap up the episode. So I guess this episode was mostly about getting your furnace chamber set up, finding a way to utilize its gases for propellant, and also getting steel. Let's see. We do have, we could, yeah, you know what? Let's see if we can have a more successful reaction with our canisters. So I think for this one, I'm just going to insert one, two, three. Oh, I hope that wasn't too much. It doesn't take much. A little bit goes a long way. And because I want leftovers, I'm just going to put one oxide. Okay, so the idea is, there it goes. Yo, we're getting some pressure now. That reaction is starting to happen. So, oh no, my oxide started. Did I put, oh, I put tons of oxide in there, not just the one, but the 30 some odd. Okay, well, let's see what that gives us here. Ooh, that's a lot of power, but not a lot of heat, and that's what we want. So 5,000 kPa. Let's go ahead and open this. Okay, it is empty, and we're going to fill this with a lot of pressure, and there you go. 416. It's going to go down a little bit, Because it was warm, but because it's mostly gas from the volatiles, we have here. Let's go ahead and take this one out. Actually, we'll put it in the locker to cool, and we'll get the other one, which is empty, and we're going to pressurize this one as well. There you go. 4400. Boom, 4400. Okay, so they are going to go down a little bit as they cool in temperature. That's going to happen. But it should be mostly waste because there was an excess volatiles in there, which is just going to mean a bunch of extra hydrogen. And then, of course, whatever impurities and such were remaining. Now, we are going to have to build a vent to vent some of this extra here. Eventually, it will depressurize on its own as the reaction stops. But the important part is that for at least for now, we have something to replace our propellant tank. Well, that about concludes the episode. So this is where we're going to wrap things up. This has been Stationeers Episode 5, where we've gone over the furnace and filling up the canister with the waste gases for extra propellant, which didn't seem to go too well because I didn't let it cool. But also, we didn't really have enough pressure to make it work in the first place. That being said, I hope you've had a good time watching. As always, I've had a good time playing. Please come back next time. As I notice, our solar panel's back at 100 degrees. That means it's a flaw in the computer logic. I'm going to have to fix that. But until next time, take care.